Well, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much. We're starting off 10 minutes late, but that is called the time of courtoisie. So I think we're starting, in fact, on time, because as you know, when airplanes land, if they're within 15 minutes of arrival time, it is considered to be on time.
Good.
We have a very distinguished panel this evening. In fact, if I recall, if some of you may know, see Northcote Parkinson, who wrote about organizations, and he talked about a cabinet. He says, you need five people to have a cabinet. Four of them need to be experts, interior, foreign affairs, exchequer, and defense. And the person who doesn't have any expertise becomes the prime minister. It seems if we apply the same concept to this situation, we have the experts, and the person without expertise heads the panel, obviously. Our panel is entitled The Endgame in the Eurozone and Europe's Prospects as an Effective Global Actor. Now, obviously there's a mistake here. Drop the rope, it is EU rather than Europe, because of course Europe is bigger than the EU, and what they have in mind when they ask this question was essentially EU, not Europe, and the endgame in the Eurozone. Well, let me introduce the members of our panel. Who need no introduction. Maybe I'm the only one that may need it, but it's my job to introduce them. We have Thomas Comar, Director, French Institute of International Affairs, otherwise known as IFRI. And then next to him is Volker Pertes, Director of the German Institute of International and Security Affairs. And then a name that most of you are familiar with, if not personally, at least when you read the newspapers. And this is Richard Haass. He's the president of the Council on Foreign Relations, but we got to know his name not through that, but in American administration in earlier times. And then the all too well known our vice chairman and president of the Global Relations Forum. The endgame in the Eurozone and EU's prospects for an effective global actor. I guess that is loaded with an assumption that the two are related. I mean, the end game in the Eurozone and Euro's prospects as a global actor. So let me start with you, Volker. End game. Is there an end game, or is it the end of the Eurozone we're talking about? What does end game of the Eurozone mean to you?
Yeah, I was wondering what it meant and what kind of sports that was referring to. I mean, it may be a kind of sports which has very, very long rounds. But no, I don't see an end game. I don't see an end. I think the Eurozone and the Eurozone crisis we have been talking about for many years is not the crisis of the day anymore. And the nice thing about crisis is that the newest crisis of the day drives out the oldest crisis. And sometimes you find out that actually the elder crises weren't as dangerous, and you think, oh, we can solve that because we have much more difficult things to deal with today. But let me say a word on the Eurozone. I think after the third bailout package for Greece, situation is actually much more relaxed than it used to be over many of the last years. The bailout package is better than previous bailout packages. Mr. Tsipras has a clear mandate to remain inside the Eurozone from his voters. And I still think he could become sort of a Greek Gerhard Schröder, I mean sort of a social democrat who does reforms that may hurt his constituency but bring his country forward. He has his mandate to keep Greece inside the Eurozone, but at the same time, the perspective of a Grexit is no longer seen as a major threat to the Eurozone or to the EU as it would have been 2 years, 3 years earlier. So it is not really that threatening crisis. But what we can do, I think, and maybe we will spend some time on that, is to say, can we learn from the Euro crisis and the way how we dealt with it for the crises of the day? Of course, it's of course a migration crisis today, the refugee crisis. I mean, that Europe is usually doing the right thing, but much too late. Mm-hmm. Right?
The wrong thing because it's
No, usually I think, I mean, this is, you have try to coordinate 28 countries. It's not so easy. So it takes a lot of time. In the end, we usually come up with the right solution, but it takes longer than it should have taken. And the Greek crisis, I think, is a very, very clear example of that. I mean, from the first rescue package, we could have done it better, perhaps. You can easily say that as an academic in hindsight, but then you have to coordinate, bring people together. And we have the same questions now, sort of the big themes when we deal with the refugee crisis, which is question of solidarity and which is a question of rules. And can we bring that together in a way that works? And I guess we come back to that.
Okay, well, what I understand from what you said is that in order to go out of a crisis, you need a bigger crisis so that you forget about
it. It's not a recipe, but it's a law of political life.
So things are of relative importance, is what you say. Okay, is that the way you see it?
You know, it seems to me, like it was said by Volker, it seems to me that the debt is manageable, you know, in Greece. I mean, it seems to me that the package is fine and things can be done, not easily, but it can be done. Now, the political consequences are very serious, and I see two of them. First of all, we avoid the Grexit, but the way of negotiating within the EU has changed dramatically, you know, with the referendum, for instance, the decision taken by the Greek authorities, the way of, I would say, managing things by Europeans has changed. And the second big thing is, in my view, the fact that this crisis also reflects the growing imbalance between France and Germany at the economic level, but also politically within the EU. And on that, I think it's something on should we should think about. It is how to manage now the relation between France and Germany, which, you know, among the GDP of France and Germany is around, you know, 5,000 billion euros. It's very important for the stability of the Eurozone. But this relationship is questioned now, I think.
Well, that's very interesting that you refer to this managing relations between France and Germany, because looking from the outside, it would be an inner directed concern rather than an external concern. So this leads me to the question in the title, and that says EU's prospects as an effective global actor. So what you're saying maybe detracts from this potential. If there is a potential, maybe not, I don't know. What do you say?
The thing is, once again, I think that the conception, you know, about the way to drive the EU has changed. And we know that the EU has a structural problem, you know. We have this common currency, but no fiscal convergence. And I think that this type of crisis can occur again. Having said that, we avoid the Grexit, and I think it's something very beneficial for all of us. And for me, the real question after the Grexit is, in fact, the Brexit, the possibility of the Brexit. Mm-hmm. So one of the main challenges now we are facing is certainly this one.
I see. Well, Richard, now you look at it from across the Atlantic, and usually it is said that the Americans are concerned about the health of European economies, but they are sometimes more concerned about security crisis. So, is that true? Or when you look across, what do you see? Do you see a sort of reliable partner?
Let's take one or two steps back. Then I will.
Please go back. Yes.
First of all, the great accomplishment of post World War II Europe is what we've seen. It's Franco-German, not just rapprochement, but the birth of a integrated relationship. I mean, for half of the 20th century, Europe was the venue of the two greatest wars in modern history, and then it was the principal venue of the Cold War. So Europe simply being stable and at peace with itself is an amazing accomplishment. And we tend to overlook it and take it for granted. So even if Europe did nothing else other than be at peace and be stable, that would be pretty good compared to the 20th century. That's already a lot of progress. Then you're asking, can it be more than that? Can Europe also be a global actor? Well, there's several things that are holding it back. One is the economic, not in the sense that we've talked. The biggest problem facing Europe economically is not the structural problem that you have a monetary system but not a fiscal parallel. The biggest problem facing Europe economically are European national economic policies. Europe has now, you know, is living with the reality of extremely low growth, You've got regulatory systems that essentially discourage job creation. It's dangerous to hire somebody because it's so difficult to let them go. You've got all sorts of rigidities. So to me, the biggest problem facing Europe is not the crisis in Greece or anywhere else. It's the condition of Europe itself. It's the underlying condition. And I don't see that changing. So one of the things that holds Europe back is itself. And its share of global GDP is gradually falling. And I think that is simply the trajectory. Second of all, it spends very little on defense. Only what, three or four countries, the European members of NATO, spend 2%. But more important,
Greece.
What Europe spends on defense makes no sense. It's not European spending. What you have are national spendings on defense, and no one is taking a step back and saying, is this coordinated? So Europe could actually have, at its current level of defense, if you added up every nation's spending, if it were centrally decided, you could have an impressive military. But the fact is, it's not. So you have lots of replication, and then you have lots of gaps. So the problem, it's almost always the case in public policy, it's not how much you spend, it's how you spend it. And this is true of virtually every country in every area, from education to health to defense, including my own. So the problem with Europe is that there's not enough Europe. If there were more Europe and you actually had a coordinated system for deciding priorities in defense and then allocating the priorities across boundaries, Europe could do something, but you don't have that. And then you've got, as has already been pointed out, a decision-making system that doesn't work. Henry Kissinger's old question, who do I call, is still a pretty good question. And we may have gone from landlines to cell phones, but the question still is there. Who do you call if you want to speak to Europe? And then Bob Gates, previously the American Secretary of Defense, spoke about a change in mentality. It's very hard to get most European publics or governments to think seriously about the rest of the world, about playing a large role. And I think the refugee crisis will have two effects. I'd be curious to see what you all said. Mm-hmm. Does the refugee crisis make Europe even more inward-looking? Or does it get Europeans, for the first time in quite a while, saying, hey, unless we start playing a larger role, say, in the Middle East, we're going to be overwhelmed by the consequences of disorder beyond Europe. The Europe can no longer be, if you will, a kind of island. So Europe now has a strategic stake, say, in the stability of the Middle East. We can't depend on the Americans. We can't depend on the Middle East itself. We, Europe, have to play a larger role. I don't know if that will be the reaction, but I think that's probably the debate that we need to see in Europe, whether it's prepared to play a larger role.
You know, what you are talking about reminded me of an experiment in building a European military machine. Remember, there was an Army of the Rhine. Volker, do you remember this? And there were certain problems with this. The German officers tended to get up early. The French officers tended to get up late. The German officers ate food with their soldiers. The French officers had a special place for their meals. One could not consume alcohol. The other drank wine with their meal.
Well, meanwhile, we both can. Yeah.
That's European defense reform.
So, I mean, you know, there are many challenges to be met in this endeavor. I mean, it's more complicated than you might.
No, Europe has in some ways proved that the whole can be less than the sum of its parts. And that's the reality of European defense.
But I suppose you wish that Europe...
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry. The basic question, of course. The United States cannot do things by itself. We either lack, there's limits to our capacity, or in many cases, you need partners. And Europe was the great strategic partner of the United States now for 70 years. And I think one of the questions going forward is, will Europe be both willing and able, both questions, to be a strategic partner of the United States going forward? And I think that to me is a large strategic question.
Let me ask you a question. You don't have to answer it if you don't want to.
Okay, I'm not running. I'm the only American not running for president, so I'm happy to answer. I'm happy to answer.
No, because, like, you have been in positions of political responsibility, and say an emergency situation, a foreign policy problem came up, and you had to sort of mobilize the Europeans in dealing with it. Would you call Brussels, or would you call London and Paris and possibly even Berlin.
If the crisis were in Europe, I would first call London, well, probably Berlin, Paris, London. And but if the crisis were in other parts of the world, I would call other parts of the world. If the crisis were in Asia, I'd call Japan, I would call Seoul, I would call Australia, and so forth. I mean, I would see Europe mainly as a partner in Europe, say on Ukraine, to some extent in the Middle East. But if the crises are possibly in selective parts in Africa, but if the crisis is in Asia, we're not going to be calling European telephone numbers.
You wanted to say something?
Yeah, I think Richard is 80% right, as most of the time. So it's
pretty good.
One of the things which, and I couldn't agree more on, sort of Europe could be a much, much stronger actor if we would be able to pool our defense resources. I usually go to audiences like that and I ask them the question and say, could you just tell me who has more soldiers, the European Union or the United States? And usually the answer from the audience is, of course, the United States, and which is not true.
Yeah.
The European Union has about 1.5 million soldiers. I think the US about 1 million. So it goes up and down. But that is because it doesn't show if you divide them by 28, and everybody has his own air force, and everybody has his own chemical weapons protection force, et cetera, et cetera. So we have to work on it. We are working on it, but again, we are working slow. I think the mistake some of our American friends are making is to sort of treat us from where we wish to be and where they wish us to be, and not from where we came from and where we are going to. Because Europe is a process. The European Union is a process. And we mustn't forget it. It's not finished. I mean, there are some member states which we have only integrated very, very recently. So it's work in progress, and it will remain work in progress, and that is, I think, what we should be judged upon. And I have the impression, just as Richard asked the question, that President Obama knows exactly whom to phone in Europe. When it's about Ukraine, I think he phoned Mrs. Merkel. If it is about Mali, he probably phones President Hollande, and why not?
You wanted to intervene,
yeah.
I think.
Maybe for the 20% where Richard is not right, it seems to me that it's maybe, you know, unrealistic to think about a European military, frankly speaking. You know, it's possible to have some combination.
Pooling.
Yes, pooling sometimes. Mm-hmm. But maybe another point of view could be to say that, in fact, two European members, I mean the UK and France, as member of United Security Nation, as the US and as Russia, use force during the last decade against sovereign countries. And what are the results of that? Do we have good results in Libya? Do we have good results in Iraq? Do we have good results in Georgia? Do we have good results in Ukraine? I think that's also the question of the use of the military tool, you know, by Europeans, Westerners, Russians, and maybe to tomorrow, you know, as in countries.
But don't you think that there seems to be a sort of lower level of willingness on the part of Germans to project military power than France and Britain?
But, you know, I let, of course, Volker respond, but we wanted to have a Bundeswehr completely under control after the Second World War. So we have it. It's very difficult for the Germany to engage their military because we wanted it. So it's part, you know, it's a consequences of our political decision taken just after the Second World War. So if there is an evolution in the German society, I don't see it, but maybe Volker will correct me, maybe. But in the current context, it's very hard to ask a German to be much more engaged on the military scene.
It seems that Japan is going through some sort of a painful
right.
decision making in the same
right.
country.
Wow. Right.
Look, I think we will never be France and we will never be the US, but maybe we don't want to. I mean, there are different
yeah.
preferences different countries have and different histories, and I'm not really sure that the rest of the world wants the Germans to go back and become militaristic as they used to be up to 1945.
Militaristic,
so
I'm projecting military power is not the same thing necessarily.
No, we have different preferences. We have learned, I think, in the years after reunification, that the military is an instrument which we can use. And we have been using it in Afghanistan, we have been using it in Bosnia, we are using it in other places, together with our European and with our NATO friends. That's new. Before that, we thought it was only for territorial defense at the eastern border of West Germany. Now, that's changed. But still, we have different preferences. I mean, when we see a crisis, the first thing the Germans, and I think it is in our post-1945 DNA, is diplomacy and development and knowledge. And for the French, I mean, the hammer of a of an army is much closer, much much higher up in the toolbox, as it were. And I guess that will remain so for some time.
You wanted to
get into
the debate.
I do want to get into that debate, because I think, really, when you look at it, Europe thrives because of its soft power. It thrives when there are no street fights around and it's a civilized global environment. It thrives when it doesn't have to deal with a crisis, but when it can preempt a crisis, because that's where its forte is. Mm-hmm. So when you think about it in those terms, I think the current conditions in Russia and also in MENA is really, I mean, I think we've been observing it, it is forcing Europe to actually act as a guardian, as a custodian of the global order by first using economic sanctions, not military. I mean, I think it is quite important that Europe was a solid partner to the US, both in Iran and in the Russian case. And I think that is the first step. And I think as if the street fight going around gets stronger and stronger, first in the neighborhood we'll hear and get more of this military muscle showing up. I don't think, as Richard said, Europe will, in the, any time near, in the near future, will actually use its economic or military muscle anywhere beyond its near neighborhood. But the first steps are there in its neighborhood. I think the economic sanctions has been a very strong sign.
Apropos what you have said, is Europe employing its powers as regards this sort of major refugee crisis, for example? Mm-hmm. Tell me more about it, because Turks often don't know about these things.
You know. The, how they can deal or how they should, the Europeans?
They should is okay. One thing. Are they dealing with it is the question.
I think this is what's happening. This is, I think, the new development around us. I'm feeling Europe is feeling that its power comes from being a soft power. That means seeing the crisis before they come up and then displaying competence at the border. And now it's happening. These are low-hanging fruits. Registering the refugees, making sure that the when you control the ships coming into Europe, you take care of it. These are not expensive organizations. And I think Europe will actually take care of these in the very near future. So we will see improvement on those fronts. That is what I sincerely expect from Europeans.
I'm impressed with your
optimism. I'm not optimistic about the economic context, which was talked about. I think there was too much optimism about the future of Eurozone. I think we overlooked the tensions, but we'll get to it through the questions.
Well, in fact, let me ask you, when you talk about the Eurozone, do you think it's likely to expand very much after this point?
I think it will expand slowly. I mean, we have seen the Baltic states entering recently. There is still an interest. There is a debate in Poland. It depends probably on the elections there. Some countries still would want to join, but yes, there will not be one big leap.
Do you anticipate a Europe of several concentric circles in the end? I mean, because the when we talk about the end game. I mean, it seems clear that there are a number of countries that not only had doubts about the euro, but about other
Schengen
and other things. So, I mean, do you see that in the future?
Possibly. But the problem we are facing in Europe at the time being is the following. I mean, the three main achievements of the European projects, the internal markets, Schengen space, and Eurozone, the last two ones are challenged. Very, very seriously. At the same time, I think we should not also forget what has been done for Europe. Mm-hmm. It's a project, it's difficult, it's a political prototype. We have to explain all the time abroad that it's something new in terms of governance. And a lot, you know, in terms of governance, a lot have been done. So I think that this this concentration, as you said, concentric circle, seems to me the proper image to describe the future. For sure, the Eurozone will be more integrated, and for sure also there will be much more flexibility, and that's why I'm coming back to my initial point with the Brexit, which will be for the future of the EU, the big issue, much more important than the Brexit in the coming years.
Talking about economics, TTIP, do you think it's got a good chance? Or?
Well,
Yeah, the first debate now is about to begin, which is over the Trans-Pacific Partnership. Mm-hmm. The dozen countries or so signed it. Yeah. Every country now has its own political process. Ours will take several months for Congress to learn about the agreement, look into it, hold hearings about it, complain about it, and then there'll be a vote early next year, early in 2016. I think that will have a big impact on whether we then have anything across the Atlantic. If the United States, which I dearly hope, supports the Trans-Pacific Partnership, and just by the way, 30 seconds on that, it'll be a very interesting set of debates, because unlike most other issues, it will not be Republicans against Democrats. It will be Democrats against Democrats and Republicans against Republicans. And you'll have splits within each party, and you'll need a large number of Republicans and a small number of Democrats to support the president, and it's going to be very, very close. Very, very close indeed, and I think it's got enormous economic and strategic consequences, one of which is if this passes, it gives momentum to doing further trade deals across the Atlantic, possibly and with the Americas, and if this either fails or can't pass, they put it on hold, and it delays everything. And my hunch is we'll know by January or so. Now, TTIP won't happen before the American election anyhow. You're still looking at 2017, 2018, but the question is, whether we now have a serious alternative to a WTO global agenda, that we have a series of regional initiatives, and this will be the principal test case. If we get this, then I think, yes, you can get TTIP. And again, like TTIP would be a very good thing economically, but it would also be a very big thing strategically. In some ways, the strategic consequences of trade deals are at least as big or bigger than the economic.
Can I come in on the actual, because I wrote the question, is the end game of the Eurozone? So since, you know, it's the question,
now you want to answer your own question?
I want to, because I think we need to close the circle in that question.
All right,
because
All right.
I mean, when you look at this Eurozone story, there are two problems. One, what you said, that the European growth, as Draghi says, is probably potential growth is around less than 1%. That's dramatic going forward. So that means you compound 3%+ for the world and 1% for Europe, you really get a sort of a smaller size Europe, not in the very distant future. So that's one big thing going on. The other thing is, because of the Eurozone parity, the single currency problem, in the South, when you look at the numbers, the French, the Italians, sorry about this, the productivity, the wages the French and the Italians get for the productivity they produce, they put on the table, there's a huge gap. So it seems the Italian and the French and the southern publics are actually getting a bit more than they generate in value. Right. And the governments are paying the difference, literally, from their pockets. That is not a sustainable system. That will not continue. And when we talk about labor reforms, all kinds of reforms, that is actually, I think, a sort of a technical way of saying these countries have to reconsider their social contracts.
Sure.
And that's a big political discussion. And the political discussion is happening, and unfortunately, I think what is happening in those countries is, until now, it seems those countries had a consensus on globalization, roughly, on European Union, roughly, on global trade, roughly. Now, the radical ends on the left and right are both saying on those three issues, we have issues with this.
Would you like to say something about Turkish-EU relationship roughly?
Okay, within this context, given the political dynamics now that they're facing in Europe, that they don't know whether they like Europe, whether they want trade, I don't think there's much of a window for Turkish-EU relations, I mean, in terms of the accession process, making much progress in the next few years. But that doesn't mean that, you know, looking at it as a 5, 10, 15 year prospect, we should think about it. When we had our former president Demirel, he said, give it time, don't worry, it will happen.
Well, this reminds me of what Chu and I said
exactly.
About the French Revolution, although I think the reference was not necessarily something.
The problem is
exactly.
Problem and confusion, it's too soon.
Too soon.
All right. Well, very good. As you can see, we have lots of things to say, and this could go on forever, but with such a distinguished audience who has taken the evening to share this experience with us, it would be unfair if we did not allow the participation of the audience in this exchange of ideas. So we're open for questions. Please. I guess we'll have to get a microphone.
Yes.
Do we have them?
Yes. Microphone. The mic is coming from there. I hope.
This gives you lots of time to formulate your question.
Exactly. Okay, it's coming. Yeah, the expectations are up, certainly. And you, John.
There was a lady there. Thank you very much. Thank you for an interesting panel. Can I ask you about a country that wasn't mentioned, and that is China? And can I ask you about Europe as an effective foreign policy actor when it comes to China? China presents a complicated challenge to the world in the sense that there's huge upside. I mean, the success it's had at home is dizzying, lifting 700 or 800 million people out of poverty and generating, driving prosperity for many of us, most of us, especially a country like mine, Australia. But on the other hand, there's a lot of uncertainty about Chinese strategic behaviour. Sometimes they are smart and constructive and cautious, indeed, slow in claiming the influence that perhaps they deserve, but sometimes they're very tough, very uncompromising. And a lot of their behaviour in their near seas is driving their neighbours closer together and closer towards the United States. But there's a lot of uncertainty about the kind of role China will play. So what kind of role can those of us in the Asia Pacific expect European countries to play vis-a-vis China? Because the criticism that most of us have is that Europe is pretty mercantilist when it comes to China. Yes. That you see it in a one-dimensional sense, if I can just finish, sir, you see it in a one-dimensional sense, but you're not seeing it in a three-dimensional sense. You're not seeing both sides of the coin, and you're not seeing China as a strategic player.
Thanks, sir. I think who would like to respond?
I can start, or you can.
Well, how Americans and Turks feel about it.
Absolutely. We didn't probably speak about China because it's not yet a member of the EU or the Eurozone. So, and then the question is whether the, yeah. No, but I think Europe is undergoing a learning process here. And if you allow me that, maybe we are getting from being mercantilist to Merkelist here on China, which is introducing a stronger value orientation and also a stronger strategic orientation into our policies to China. It's clear that, and that goes for Australia as much as for the US, as for the EU, that China is an enormously important trade partner, and this will not go away, this will rather increase, and we appreciate it actually. But one of the answers as to what do we do about China is actually TTIP. That we're trying to refurbish and strengthen the economic and trade relationship with the U.S. In terms of influencing the global standards which count in the world. And I guess if we do what we have set out to do and we finish TTIP in due time, we will have some impact and the Chinese will probably play with it. If we let ourselves be divided up, the Chinese will do what they already tried to do in Europe, namely play divide and rule, reach out to some of the Eastern European and Central European partners and try to form their own relationships, which actually do not correspond to European law. And once you ask the Chinese, and we're doing it, they say, oh, we are not experts in European law. We didn't actually know that we cannot have trade agreements with just 13 countries out of the 28 or so. I think we are learning that's a short answer, that our relationship with China is not only an economic one, that there is a strategic aspect to it. That doesn't mean that we are going to send the German Navy, which is not so big in the first place, to the South China Sea, but it means that we are getting interested, and here I speak into an Australian, in having closer relationship, for example, with providing submarines to your country, which means that you're not only selling a product, which means that you are getting interested in the geopolitical environment there, that you tie yourself to servicing these kind of things, that you're trying yourself in setting up production facilities in a country, and get involved in the strategic environment there.
Yes, very briefly, three points to respond to your question, Michael. China can be tough, as you said, but is much more careful than the other members of the United Security Council, the US, Russia, France, and the UK, for sure. And I think it will continue for the next years. The second point is to continue what was said by Volker about the consequences of the mega trade agreements laid by the US on the Pacific side and the Atlantic side. Three big countries are out of this discussion: China, Russia, and Brazil. And the evolution of the relation between China and Russia seems to me very important in terms of strategic orientation. The evolution of the triangle between the US, China, and Russia is absolutely critical for all of us. Because to some extent, that's the three countries which do consider that they can break international law when they want. Maybe that's because I have a sort of Russian tropism that I say that, but I think it's very important for Europe to try to anticipate the evolution of this triangle. And the last point is also we should, as Europeans, try to anticipate the new Silk Road. Is it only mental map or is it something serious? And what sort of combination could we expect between Silk Road and the Eurasian Economic Union, which was not taken seriously, which in my view was a mistake, but certainly it will impact Europeans in the coming years.
Thank you very much. What would you like to say?
I mean, I think Michael's question contained within it the seed of a slight difference, where the European emphasis has been narrower, it's been more economic. And the question, it's not a question that the German Navy going sailing in the Pacific, that's not the issue. The issue is whether Europe is a strategic partner of the United States and other countries such as Australia, Japan, and South Korea in dealing with China. And that means in thinking about technology transfer, that means in thinking about China's unwillingness to use the influence it has with North Korea, which could well be the first big foreign policy crisis, I would think, in the next US administration. It could mean China's behavior in cyberspace. What kind of behaviors do we try to encourage or discourage? And to the extent the United States and Europe can come up with roughly common positions, whether it's in trading issues, climate issues, cyber issues, or more broadly strategic issues, then it increases the incentive of, the purpose is not to keep China out, it's to bring China into regional and global arrangements, but on terms that we would welcome. So to the extent that Europe is a partner on that and has a broader perspective on China, and I was interested to hear what Volker had to say, that he thinks the European approach to China is getting broader. If that's the case, then that would clearly be welcome from the American point of view.
I'll just say a few words. I think when we say strategy, everyone thinks of security strategy, but there's also economic strategy. And in the case of Europe now, I think German growth, a good portion of German growth is through exports, and most of it is linked to Asia and China. So I think from a German economic strategic perspective, there are limits to how much they would depend on the growth and the goodwill of China going forward. So there's a natural limit in the economic sphere. And I think, knowing many German friends, they do have these concerns that there are limits to this. On the more security strategic aspect, I think Europe still, well, rightly, feels that the geographic proximity is critical, and the way they look at Russia and China in the global order is obviously very different. And I think the Chinese risk, security-related risks, are outsourced to the US. The only way, I mean, the geography is a reality in this. The only few issues, and I think Richard mentioned the most important one, cybersecurity has no geography. So the test case for me, watching Europe, is whether Europe will take it as seriously as the US in the cyber domain to deal with the Chinese behavior. That, I think, is where we'll see. Because the other one, the geographic proximity, is too deeply ingrained. That there's nothing we can do about that. But the other one is a near-term issue, and I'm curious to see how forceful Europe will act on the cyber issue.
Also, a lot of the assumptions about thinking about China in my country and elsewhere is that China continues one degree or another to rise. I would think for the next few years, it's at least as possible as not that China has major difficulties. I think it's domestic contradictions are coming to the fore. I actually think Xi Jinping has what is perhaps the most difficult inbox of any contemporary leader. And if I'm right, and China does experience significant internal difficulty, then again, some coordination between the United States and Europe about how to react, say, to a China that has massive internal dislocations, political instability and unrest, I would think would be quite important.
Mr. You stole my remarks.
I apologize.
You shouldn't do that, but...
I'm only an 80% kind of guy. So this is part of the 20%.
No, but I think the point was very well taken that we make this assumption that this is a land of permanent rise, which is not necessarily a warranted assumption. However, talking about geography, one has to be aware that China's geographical conceptions are rather comprehensive. Recently, they have been pushing this Silk Road, but it's not just a land road, it's also a sea lanes, etc. And I am aware that they are trying to project this sort of thing through Turkey, too.
And goes into Europe.
So one has to recognize that China does do many things to...
Yeah, but again, what's more important than what China does, it's how it does it. It's where U.S. foreign policy, I think we got it wrong, for example, with the Asia Infrastructure Bank. To have opposed that was, to me, wrong. I mean, we want to encourage China to play responsible roles in regional and global institutions. So the fact that they're getting more involved in South Asia or other parts of it is in and of itself, that's neutral. It's how it goes about it. And are there certain types of behaviors on the part of China we want to encourage or discourage? But China is going to be a larger factor. The question is, what's the character or personality of that larger factor?
Thank you. More questions? Yes, I cannot see very well. Rami Bey and Danke Gurias.
My question is to Richard.
Don't ask me who's going to be the next president.
How do you see the European Union evolve in the next 10 years to come?
Next 10 years to what?
To come.
European Union. In the coming 10 years, how is it going to evolve? Thank you.
It's interesting. I would think it would be quite recognizable. So I would, if you have at one end a totally integrated Europe, not just monetary, but fiscal, much more of a common security policy, I don't see that happening. I think nationalism is actually quite strong in Europe. On the other hand, if you think of Europe disintegrating and falling apart, I don't see that either. So I see it in some ways now. A combination of some areas, uneven. In some areas, the degree of integration is stronger. In some cases, it's more selective, certain countries doing things. But all in all, quite familiar to the way it is now. That would be my guess for the foreseeable future.
Thanks. Do I see Grigoriadis? Do I see correctly?
My name is Yanis Grigoriadis from Birken University. My question came out of a remark by Dr. Bertes, but I would be very glad if other panelists would respond. You referred to two words which I consider to be very important, Dr. Bertes. You talked about rules in terms of dealing with the Eurozone crisis and solidarity. Can there be a trade-off in the near or medium future when addressing the crisis, or will solidarity come against respect for rules, and will respect for rules come against solidarity? And how do you project this as a potential future problem? And I refer in particular to the case about Greek debt and possible forgiveness of it.
Should I?
Please go ahead, yes.
I think there is no contradiction. It's sort of two pillars on which the European Union rests, and it's much easier to display solidarity if you have also rules how to organize this solidarity. Take the refugee crisis, take the euro crisis. Now, we have one state now who has been bitterly complaining about the mandatory decision of the ministers of interior to distribute a small part of the refugees according to a quota. So what did Mr. Fico of this country, which I didn't name, Slovakia, what did he say? He promised his own people, we are going to resist it, we are going to the European Court of Justice. Fine, that's rule of law. So he didn't want to give in to this demand of being in solidarity, forgetting, I would say, a little bit how many refugees under communist times there were from these countries in Europe or in America, but let's set aside. And he said, I'm going to court. Fine, so we have rules, and he will lose in court, and then he can go to his people and say, we are good Europeans, we accept the decision of a court. So you always have to have the two. I would like to say a sentence on this. It wasn't addressed to me, but the question, where will Europe develop? And I think we have philosophically probably to understand that some of the truisms we used, or the mantras we used, are probably no longer totally correct. We used to say Europe is a Europe of different speeds, which used to mean that in the end, everybody will arrive, like in a marathon. Some will take 4 hours, some will take 8 hours, but in the end, they will all arrive. Right? That was sort of the philosophy of the European Union, different speeds. I think that's no longer the case. We will have different degrees of integration. And we will, I mean, certain opt-outs have become a reality that will stay. If the British don't want to be part of the Schengen zone, I think it's at their loss, but it's their decision, and we will accept it. I think others, like the Danes, at some point will opt in into the Eurozone and will opt in into common foreign and security policies, but for the time being, they don't want. So we will not only have different speeds, we will have different zones of integration, which means that you will have one European Union, but in different aspects, you will have still national policies. But there's one thing that also changes, and here I think it's the crisis in the Middle East and the refugee crisis. Mind you, for the first time, the European Union is building its own coast guards. So it will be a European Union with hardened borders. And that is a big change. And it throws up questions for Turkey. On which part sort of the border will you be in the end? And I think that is something which the European Union and Turkey hasn't discussed deeply enough. How do we integrate Turkey into foreign security policies? Or how do we coordinate security policies? We are talking about it, but we are not actually coordinating.
I actually think it's an interesting area that Volker just opened up. So much of the conversation about Europe and Turkey has been whether Turkey is formally in. I think we can park that question to the side for quite a while. It's almost secondary. What really matters is what's the reality of the relationship in various functional areas. And I think that is the serious conversation about Turkey and Europe. And it's a serious conversation for Turkey, and it's a serious conversation for Europe.
Well, that's a very serious observation, I might note. But let me also make a serious remark. I mean,
please.
You know, it's often not prudent in our experience to use courts to settle political problems. Because, you know, when you were explaining the Slovakian position, this was precisely the point you were making. Our experience is that by passing on political problems to the courts, you don't necessarily solve the problem, you destroy the court. But then, obviously, the outcome in Europe might be somewhat different than how
things
work.
We have a better experience using courts.
Makes it easier for weak politicians to take hard decisions sometimes.
All right. But then, in the process, would you think something is lost in terms of the court? Maybe not.
No, I don't think
so. In the United States, it's worked pretty well having the courts take certain decisions.
All right. Questions, please?
The lady.
Hans Elena.
Thank you. When one looks at the world, we see US, Europe taking a bigger share of the world GDP, and then when we go towards the East, we see 2 billion people living below $2 a day. We see wars, we see gender inequality, we see lack of rule of law, all the values that the liberal democracy represent. And we believed after the Cold War that the way to development, sustainable development, goes through these values. We see a part of the world where there are no these values, there is gender inequality, you know, wars, and When I look at the world, I see US trying to be the champion of these values, one way or another, being active in those part of the world, trying to help them develop, those underdeveloped countries. My question is to my European friends: A, do you think this is sustainable? Do you think this inequality is sustainable? And by building, thicker walls, can you prevent your security, your wealth? Today we are seeing thousands of immigrants. We're gonna see millions maybe one day. I mean, so my question is, do you think Europe can protect itself, the value system, the economy, the freedom, the democracy, by building walls? Or should Europe take a more active role in helping the developing world?
So.
It's a very large and relevant question. For sure, there is a need for co-developments with massive investment, for instance, in North Africa, in Middle East, and so on. So I think that's very clear. Now, in terms of values, I think there is a proportion between your power and your ability to defend your values. And the fact that Europe appears less powerful than it was just after the end of the Cold War explain maybe these doubts about values. But at the same time, it's at the core of the European project. So I think that if we don't believe in these values to some extent, we could stop, the European project. That's why I'm rather optimistic also, because as you said, gender equality, pluralism, democracy, are, in my view, aspiration, which are largely shared, even if we have some populist movements in Europe at the time, but which are largely shared in Europe and elsewhere. And obviously, we should rely on these strengths.
You wanted to say
I will, but do you want to get involved?
No, I agree to Thomas.
Okay. Alzheimer, when I think we look at that problem, it seems the way to bring people above the poverty line is really through getting them integrated into the global workforce. That seems to be the most effective way. We watch China, we watch India, and it seems Europe does have a role to play because of the size of its market. So when the Arab uprisings started, one hoped, and they said it, the Europeans actually started off on this line, that mobility, meaning some controlled migration, monetary aid, some help, but most importantly, market access, giving access to those economies to sell their products so that the economies get going. Unfortunately, that process got nowhere. And I think looking back, I don't know if Volker and Thomas agree with me, I think that was a big failure. It was a failure in terms of the way Europe is perceived, because that was the time when Europe could have used its economic and soft power. I mean, I'm not saying it would have ended, made the story better, but at least it would have given a sign that the West and Europe is pushing, trying. I think that was a failure. So, and I'm hoping that going forward, that will change. That is the kind of contribution I would expect from Europe going forward.
I thought I, yes, yes, Elena.
Yes, thank you. My question comes from something that Richard said about the strategic importance of the TTIP and how it's not merely a free trade agreement, but much more in terms of the transatlantic relationship. And my question is, what will that mean then if the TTIP is not signed in the end, particularly now that it seems that TPP is going ahead? I mean, what will it say about the transatlantic relationship if the US managed to get this kind of trade deal through with the Pacific states and not with the partner in values, norms, Europe? And I'd like, if possible, to hear your opinion about two events that will precede a potential TTIP agreement, which is the British referendum and the US elections. How could these affect that?
Here we go.
I'll say one or two things. First, take it one step back. With TPP, it's essential, I would say, it get passed, because if it doesn't get passed, there'll be no TTIP, and it will also create major problems for the United States around the world about American predictability, reliability, about our ability to partner with our close friends and allies, particularly in Asia. It'll have consequences for China's position. So it would be a strategic setback of the first order, if we can. Now, TTIP would, actually, the impact of TTIP economically might be slightly larger than the impact of TPP economically. I actually think the potential for TTIP to be an economic growth engine across the Atlantic is significant. So, and particularly given where Europe is in its growth, I think it could be a useful engine of some sort there. I think it's also good to have reminders that the transatlantic relationship can benefit both sides, because this generation often forgets that. And even if strategic cooperation in some areas is not as thick, this is another way of demonstrating that this relationship works, and it might have some momentum for other things. If there isn't TTIP, a lot also depends upon why. I think there's a big difference if it's seen as one side or the other, unable or unwilling to make certain types of compromises and all that. The U.S. election will make all this probably slightly more difficult, but then the election will end, thank God. And since TTIP is largely a post-2016 reality, the election will come and go. And assuming a protectionist is not the next president, then I think we're okay. And indeed, it could make it better, because protectionism will have been seen to have been defeated. So it's quite possible that on both sides, if protectionist candidates come up short, it could actually help the political environment. I think the Brits getting out would be bad. It's one of the attractions of this. I actually, just 30 seconds on that, I wish Prime Minister Cameron had never made this commitment. I don't think it was necessary, and I think now it is going to come back to haunt him and potentially his country and Europe and the transatlantic relationship. At best, it's an enormous distraction. But for him now, given everything else that Chancellor Merkel and Monsieur Hollande and everyone else is coping with, for now him to go knocking on the door and say, we need better terms, it's, shall we say, parochial. And it's unlikely he can come away with enough that would help him clinch the deal at home. So I almost wish he would say, to put off, say, well, when I made this commitment, it was in one set of geopolitical circumstances. Mm-hmm. Now they've changed. That's probably asking too much. But you almost say life is tough enough without making things tougher. And I think what he has done is made things tougher for himself, for Europe, and for the transatlantic relationship. It really is unfortunate.
Is there a name associated with protectionist candidate that you...
Well, it's actually, no. Again, as I said before, it's in both parties. You see it in the Democratic side, both people running like Mr. Sanders, as well as people like the senator from Massachusetts and others. And we see it, Senator Warren, and we see it on the Republican side, Mr. Trump and others. We have, but also Mr. Cruz, Mr. Huckabee, we see it on both sides. Mm-hmm. So we're seeing populism around the world. America's not immune from it. There's inequality, there's lots of... People are focused on American jobs, unemployment. The much more interesting number in the United States is employment. American employment rates are still around 4% lower. So you have millions of Americans who never went back to work, and they're looking at their futures, they're living longer, and they don't see how Social Security is going to get them through. So populism is gaining ground in the United States, just as it is over on this side of the ocean. That's simply a reality.
All right, one last question. You wanted to ask a question? Or?
Yeah.
Hi, I'd like to share some Asian perception of the EU. I think we have to distinguish the European, some leadership of some European countries, and also leadership of the EU as a region. I think many Asians believe Europe can be an alternative Western influence, which can be independent of USA. And many European countries took a leadership in development assistance and humanitarian issues and many climate changes. So you still have a very influential role in international society. However, as a regional unit, as the EU, many Asians are disappointed. You know, I think about 10 years ago, when the European integration was at the high point, many Asian countries, when we started East Asian regionalism, we have to learn from EU to taming the nationalism and transcending nationalism, and we discussed even introducing Asian currency, like a European currency, yeah? So we kind of idealized European Union as a future of East Asian regionalism. However, for the last 10 years, many Asian countries got disappointed as the EU is deepening its membership. You know, you've been caught up with the internal challenges, right? The currency issues and the refugee issues, so many things. So actually, I observe the European Union is losing its external influence beyond European continent, and very far away from the Asia-Pacific region. So I wonder how this you see the dynamics for the internal integration is actually contributing to more challenges that is leading to your loss of influence.
Thank you. Just short answers, short responses.
I'll let the Europeans defend
themselves. Let's start with you, and let's on that happy note, we might maybe conclude.
maybe to react, you know, and to come back to the title about Europe as a global actor and not as a global power. I think we need two big things which are still, you know, to be set up. The first one is the true roots of global presence, in my view, are energy policy, and on that, the EU has a lot to do. Even if the energy transition has been started, and that's a deep evolution, with huge consequences. The second thing, and it's a way to be back to the question about the relation between China and the US, it is Europe should set up very quickly a real digital policy, because at the time being, you know, it's completely under the control of the US, which is part, I think, of the maybe strategic alliance, you know, against China. But that's something very challenging also in terms of public liberties and individual liberties. And last thing, I think it's very important for Europe to have the possibility maybe to prosecute US companies like European companies are prosecuted in the US. I mean, this imbalance, I don't know if the TTIP negotiation will reworked, you know, will be much fair on that, but we have a huge problem on that at the time being.
I understand totally what you're saying about the disappointment, but let me answer you in a way which probably also disappoints you. I was always critical of those of my compatriot Europeans who wanted to say that Europe is a model for the rest of the world. I said the rest of the world should learn from what we're doing, but it's not necessarily a model which you copy and paste to other regions. So you look at our experience, we look at your experience, maybe we certainly started earlier with regionalism. So look at what mistakes we make. It's a big chance for others to look at the mistakes as well as to the achievements, but it's not necessarily a model. And I think Asians very early made clear that they don't want to take all of the European philosophy of giving up sovereignty, for example, and pooling sovereignty on a higher level. But your disappointment, or the disappointment of the Asians you spoke of, doesn't concern me so much as the disappointment of some Europeans about Europe. That is a real threat. And that is, I mean, Richard said, we are not isolated from what is happening in the rest of the world, neither are we. Populist movements coming up in a lot of European countries. Mrs. Le Pen with her Front National becoming the second or the first party in France. These are things that concern me very much. Our populist parties now being almost in all the governments of the Scandinavian countries, that concerns me a lot. Populist parties in Eastern Europe, that concerns me. We may have them in parliament in Germany after the next elections. And what is the reason for that? That newer generations and sometimes older generations of Europeans are no longer convinced by the European project. How do we get that right? Of course, the first thing is always getting your economy right. I mean, unemployed people are more likely to be Eurosceptic than people who have a job. It is sometimes so easy. The other thing is, and maybe that's a note you didn't expect, I wasn't too unhappy about border controls being reintroduced for a couple of days on the borders of Germany, because it made people realize that there is something to lose if you destroy some of our principles in Europe. Most of the younger people, those I teach at university or so, they don't know that 20 years ago we had border controls. They simply don't know the concept. So it's probably good for them to see that this could come back if we don't preserve what we have in terms of European unity. So that wasn't so bad. And I think, as always, we're getting our act together, but we will do that too late.
Thanks. Of course, our youth knows what border controls means very well.
You
maybe
know that very
they
well.
Should go through a period so that they won't remember that there were border controls. Are you disappointed? Or what would you like to say?
The only thing is logistics. So if you want to close the panel and then I'll...
No, I want to...
You want to get the final word?
I think
I'm not disappointed, but I'm worried.
Sorry.
What worries me about Europe is the rise of nationalism, the rise of populism, the prospects for low economic growth, the generational change. So the impetus that led to Europe after World War II is gone. New generations take it for granted or just don't care about it. And I think that also adds to my concern. So to me, my skepticism about Europe, it's not an anti-European position, it's a worried about Europe. So I don't quite share Volcker's optimism that in the end, when everything, a little bit like what Churchill said about Americans, they can be trusted to do the right thing after they've done everything else. I'm not sure I feel that about Europe, that it will ultimately it'll sort itself out, even if it takes a long time. I'm a little bit worried about that, particularly given some of the demographic realities. And I think the most realistic thing we heard, and I think both Thomas and Volker made this image, is really of multiple Europes. Mm-hmm. That rather than thinking of Europe as a singular thing, however wide it is, the depth and the kind of selective degrees of integration become the reality. And I think we're headed much more towards, if you will, a more complex rather than a single reality.
All right, now from the people who made this evening possible, another announcement.
Again, we thank everyone, of course, for being here tonight. From here, as you know from the program, GRF members and our COC guests, we move to dinner, and we thank all our guests, journalist guests, and from other institutions who are here with us tonight for their time, and we look forward to welcoming them in other events. Thank you very much.
So, may I?
Thank you very much.
Well done.
Thank you.